In his talk called Undiluted Truth, inspired by 2 Corinthians chapter 4, Assistant Pastor Warren McNeil says, Paul's experiences of telling the gospel truth came with power and persecution. Persecution came from both outside and inside the body of believers, yet he never veiled the truth of the gospel from anyone. Warren shows that we have to herald an undiluted gospel to those around us so that no power is removed from the message of our King. Wow.
Lord, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning so far, Lord. We thank you for time spent with you, worshipping you. Thank you that we was able to take communion this morning, celebrating your death and resurrection, remembering what it is that you have done for your church, done for your creation, so that we can be church. Lord, as we look at your word now, I pray that you'll challenge and speak to us in the name of Jesus. Amen. Prior to me going on holiday, way, way back in August, I spoke on the passage 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Anybody remember that? Thank you, Joan. Great. Joan remembers it. Well, the rest of you, it's on the website if you really want to look it up. So to give you a bit of background about the letter 2 Corinthians, it was written by both Paul and Timothy to the church at Corinth. The church at Corinth was made up mainly of Gentile converts, i.e. people that were involved in pagan temple worship who have now converted to Christ. That's the simplest way to define it in one sentence. What was also going on was that some Jewish converted Christians had arrived at Corinth and were trying to convince the church that they needed to take on some of Moses' law to be true Christians, to be true followers of the way. They needed to take on some of Moses' law. Both parties was born out of the fact the question is, they wanted to know, how do you fully participate in the power of the Holy Spirit? And for the Jewish Christians, their view was, well, you need to be a bit more pure, and you therefore then needed to be freer of sin. And the best way to do that was clearly to follow some of the Jewish law. Paul's quote is defending that and saying, no, that is wrong. Jesus didn't come to bring in extra rules and laws. He brought in a relationship. So when I ended the sermon, that's how we ended at the fact that it's not built on condemnation, which is what the Jewish law brought. It was actually built on freedom of relationship through our Lord Jesus Christ to the Father. Do I get at least a little amen?
Amen.
Thank you very much. And I based it around about some of the subjects around Galatians chapter 5 and fruits of the Spirit, and the fact actually these are not benchmark rules. These are what are born out of a relationship, okay? So that's where we're at. So we're going to carry on. We're going to look at 2 Corinthians 4. Now, I always wish to say about the Jewish Christians, which are known as the Judaizers. See, I can't pronounce it. And I have practiced, John. And I just decided I'm just going to call them the Jewish Christians for now, because it just makes my life a little bit easier. And I obviously don't mean people that are Jews for Jesus now, or people that were Jewish are Christians now, or they're, you know, I don't mean today. I just mean in this context of this letter, okay? There was something else they were trying to do, because one of the things that was going on was there's lots of suffering and persecution happening. And what the Jewish Christians were saying was, well, to get out of this persecution, to get out of this suffering, we obviously need to be a bit more pure, need to follow the law of Moses a little bit more. And then, you know, you'll be released from this. And Paul is saying, no, this is wrong. That is not true. You actually suffer because you do follow Christ. I know there are churches around the world that actually do sort of say that no bad thing will come your way if you're really true to Christ. I'm sorry, the gospel that I believe in guarantees if you are true to Christ, you will suffer. There's nothing wrong in praying into suffering. There's nothing wrong in praying for God to stop things. You see that through the Bible. But don't sit there and think by being a Christian you'll be free from the troubles of this world. Guarantee you will cop a lot more trouble. It's like driving up the road the wrong way. Guaranteed you'll have a lot more accidents on the way through, yes? I still believe in a God who does release us from trouble and get us out of trouble, but we also get into trouble because we're true to Christ. So I just wanted to say that. So this is what Paul is trying to say, and Paul emphasizes that, just don't need to turn to it, but in chapter 1, verse 8, he says, "We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about the hardships we suffered in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure, so that we despaired even of life." That was not an easy time. Even to the point of despairing of life, that was the pressure that they endured. So it's in that context, in that sort of conversation, we're going to look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4. So, verses 1 to 6. "Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the mind of unbelievers, so that they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ." I will say this, is again not a tidy passage, and again there is so much to unpack that I would need about a year's worth of lectures at my college to maybe get through about the first seven verses. There is a lot. So we're going to not look at everything as deep, and you might look at something and say, "Oh, but you missed that, Warren." Yep. There's probably reasons why I've missed that verse, and you can always look at it for yourself at a later date. So, therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. Bold words to use. Very bold words to use. The ministry. Let's again just clarify that Paul is talking about his apostolic ministry. He's talking about the fact that he is an apostle of Jesus Christ. And that is what he's talking about, sort of not losing sight of and holding on to it. But we can pick out stuff for ourselves, because those of us that have accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior, you are a royal priesthood. And we all have, as royal priests, a ministry in some nature. So there are ways that we can take chunks of this and say, yes, I can apply this to me. Okay? So ministry. It's a ministry that he is saying is actually because of God. It's got nothing to do with him. He's not put himself in that position. God has put him in that position. God has said, this ministry, Paul has said, this ministry is ours because God gave it to us. Effectively, God employed us to do this. So no matter what the great persecution may be, they do not lose heart, because they know that God has given it to them. The trouble they may go through, they will not lose heart because they know that God has given it to them. There's meant to be a sense of rest and a sense of reassurance in that statement. Now, what about if you, and in whatever you do for God, you know that God has given to you? There's plenty in this room who part of volunteer groups, lead groups, help in Sunday club and various other events, not just in this church, but outside. And these are places where you have a ministry that's been given to you by God. And they're not always the easiest of times, are they? There are sometimes trouble comes your way. There's grief that comes your way. But because when you know in your heart that God has given you that ministry, you don't lose heart. That's the idea. And this is what Paul's talking about. We'll come to later on. I have no illusions that we can and do lose heart. But Paul is saying here, no matter what the persecution, no matter what the grief, into the point of despair of death, I do not lose heart, because this is a new ministry he has been given. What about your workplaces? How many of us before now have prayed about work or college, want a college place, or want to be in a certain place or a position, and we praise God and we thank God for it, and then 3 months, 4 months down the line, maybe when the workplace is not quite as cozy and quite as lovely as we would like, we start losing heart, even though we know God has given us this role for now. Maybe even given us retirement. We're praising God, hallelujah, I'm retired, I've got all this time on my hands. And then discovered you've got a lot more time than you... all right, Joan, some maybe not. But some, you know, your time, suddenly you realize you've got more in your hands than you know what to do with, and you start losing heart. Well, God's given it to you for a reason. Don't lose heart. There's reasons for things to happen. Don't lose heart. So this is what Paul is saying in their ministry, even though they clearly got trouble and clearly things are not going too well and they're actually being opposed by these Jewish Christians. They're being opposed by them. They're actually saying about Paul and Timothy that they are false teachers. We'll come to that in a minute. They're being accused of being false teachers. I mean, Paul, Saint Paul, is being accused of being a false teacher. Ever accused of being that? You're false as a Christian. You can't be a Christian. Look at the way you acted. That's not true. Paul also be accused, and we'll come to that in a moment. The issue was that the Jewish Christians were clearly hanging on to, I was hoping I would get there, but no, clearly hanging on to the Mosaic law. They really wanted to hold on to parts of the old covenant, part of the rules, part of the regulations. They really felt clearly this was a continuation. It's like that Jesus didn't come to do away with it, which Jesus didn't. He came to fulfill it. But it doesn't mean you stick to some of the rules and the regulations and the rituals that are involved. They're still hanging on to that. They've not recognized yet that the cross has effectively superseded the old covenant. So they're hanging on to it. And for them, what Paul is preaching, and you can see this, Paul is preaching release from that and saying, no, this is like a new dynamic in the relationship. They're deciding that actually Paul is giving false teaching. Totally and utterly false teaching. They're actually saying at the worst he is a heretic, at best he's diluting the message. Now that's interesting. At best, Paul is diluting the real gospel. I can understand where they're coming from, and I hope you can. As Jewish people, they were waiting for the Messiah to come. All they've had for thousands of years leading up to that is the Torah. yearly festivals, yearly sacrifices, yearly quotes, certain psalms being read or sung, should I say, at certain points through the year. That is what they've had, knowing that is how they are to be kept right with God. Circumcision for the men. I'm so pleased I'm in this end of the covenant. Circumcision for the men. These things, these symbols, these signs that says that you are a people of God. And then you have Paul saying, Paul, who was a trained Israelite theologian, went, no, you don't do any of that anymore. It's about relationship. You're set free from your sin because of what Christ did, not anything that you have to go ahead and do. So I can understand they're opposing Paul. I can understand that they're thinking, hang on a minute, if we've had this for so long, why is it not applied now in this Jewish Messiah? Surely he would have carried on. So you can understand their thinking, but Paul is saying no. So Paul is being, saying he's diluting the real message. He's diluting the message to appeal to the masses. He's diluting the message to appeal to the Gentiles. This is part of it. So this is part of why we have verse 2, when he says, rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. That is a hard statement to make. Reason being he's saying we do not use deception is because he's being used and accused of being deceptive in his message, not quite telling the whole truth. This is the understanding. Here's a thought for you. You see in the Old Testament, you can actually follow the Moses' law. You could actually become part of the Jewish nation if you went through a process of stuff and accepted the Lord God, Yahweh, as your absolute Lord and God, and then went through various processes to be accepted partially into the Jewish nation. But there were lots of hoops to jump through, lots of strict rules to jump through, lots of festivals that you would have to attend and be in a particular way. It looked, I'm sure, to some restrictive. You would have to abstain from certain lifestyles, like going to other pagan temple places to do blood sacrifices there, or temple prostitution or whatever. You was not allowed to be involved in those. So it looks restrictive to become a Jew. So when you have Paul who's trying to show the fact that it is being a Christian is not so restrictive, it's actually about freedom of relationship, you can understand the Jewish people thinking, no, you're being really restrictive. You're actually diluting the message, the real message. They need to follow certain rules. You are diluting, not giving its full strength and quality to them. They don't know. But Paul refutes that, saying, no, we're setting forth the truth plainly. He's saying, we're not diluting, I'm not veiling, we're not being deceptive. I'm telling the truth in a very straight and plain way. Telling it like it is. Not throwing in a whole bunch of rules and whatever else to confuse and to shake it up. I am telling the truth plainly. And for Paul, he's saying the truth has power. Why would you distort or dilute the very message that brings life rather than the Old Testament message which brings death and condemnation? Because he's commending himself to every man's conscience in the sight of God. Why would I be diluting a message that brings life rather than condemnation? What about you? Are you quite comfortable to bring the message, truth, plainly and simply, that brings life and not condemnation? Or do we sometimes dilute the message and the gospel because we want to appeal to the masses? Last time when I preached this all in the context of Acts 1:8. I actually like the fact in 2 Corinthians it's 1:8 that Paul talks about serious persecution. In this 1:8, it's you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Part of being a witness is about giving the message. But do we dilute it? And by doing that, do we remove its power? Now you're saying, no, Warren, I'm sure we don't dilute the message. We tell people very, very plainly that Jesus is Lord. Do we? Might say that. But then when the questions start coming about, well, what does that mean about salvation? What does that mean about hell? What does that mean about maybe some relatives have not known Jesus yet? What's going to happen to them? Do we then start going, oh, hang on a minute, need to back up a little bit here and try and show sort of gentle love to them in the process? Are we ashamed of the gospel? If we heard those statistics right this morning, and in 5 years, 90% of the church attendance happening now will not exist in 5 years' time, there's something very wrong with the gospel message that we are giving. Sometimes we worry too much about our reputation with our friends, family, work colleagues. We want to be liked. Who wants to be liked? Excellent. The rest of you don't. Brilliant. Right. You don't have to listen to this then because you don't care who you tell about Jesus then. Who likes to be liked by Christians and non-Christians? Who likes to have a good reputation, be able to approach somebody and just be able to have a friendly conversation with them without worrying about whether they like them or not too much? You know you can go and approach them. But if they know that you're a Christian, they might have a bit of a, ooh, there's a Christian. Yeah, they're a bit weird. That's true of us Christians, but hey, let's move on. But that's got nothing to do with knowing Jesus. That's just to do with us. The gospel has power. Do I get an amen at least? But the gospel really does. It's good news. That's what gospel means. It's good news. Who likes good news? I love good news. But good news always comes with a sense of, well, it's good news, but you've got to understand this. There is only one way. There's not multiple roads. In our society today, we like the idea of multiple roads to heaven. Multiple roads to God. This one points to, yes, Eastern spirituality over there. That still will get me to God. It's not a problem. This one, atheist, but it's okay. My later life, I can still come to know God. It's not a problem. I will be forgiven ultimately. This road over here, this points to postmodernism. Choose whatever you want. Up to you. No problem. Choose whatever you feel like, throw in a bit of this religion, throw in a bit of that strange book, self-help book, throw in a bit of this. That points to God. Anyway, the road will still lead to God. And there's the sign with the incredibly narrow road that says Jesus. John 14:6, only way. We don't like those, we like multiple choices, not the narrow road. People don't like to hear that message, that there is only one way. And we can dilute the message when we don't hold fast to that as Christians, when we try and be so culturally relevant in our delivery of the message gets completely and utterly diluted in the cultural relevancy. Sometimes we have to set the truth plainly and simply, no matter the grief that will come our way. I mean, I'm no evangelist by a long shot. But what I've noticed is that we can remove the power of the gospel when we don't do specifically what it asks and we don't hold to it truly and speak it plainly. I said to you last week when I preached about we can lose the power of the gospel when we think, oh dear, when we live on, oh dear, I've done wrong today, so the Holy Spirit's not going to use me. I can't walk in the power of the Holy Spirit. That's one way of losing the power. The other way of losing the power is not to speak it plainly, is to dilute it. Anybody had Robinson's, and there are other brands in the supermarket, but Robinson's orange squash? One that you're meant to dilute. The one they use in Wimbledon, basically, and other brands as well that are available in the supermarkets. But Robinson's orange squash. Yeah, who's had it? You know, you put a little bit in and you put water in it, don't you? You dilute it, yeah? To make it taste better. Yeah. I mean, it is good. Yeah, don't have it undiluted. But let me say this to you. Sometimes the power of the gospel has two effects. It's either really sweet to somebody's taste in its raw, concentrated format, or it really upsets and causes pain and division in its raw, concentrated format. And I think we miss some of the passages in the Bible when Jesus said, I came here not to bring peace, but to divide. Because the gospel does divide. Hebrews 4 says that the word of the Lord is like a double-edged sword cutting through bone and marrow. Believe you me, that is not a comfortable gospel. But whatever it is truth, it is sharp, and it points, and it says, this is it. So don't dilute it. I can assure you, undiluted Robinson's orange squash is kill or cure. I know this personally from many, many prior to being a Christian years ago. If you drink it, it will do one or two things. It'll either settle your stomach or it'll do the complete reverse. The gospel can be the same. In an undiluted format, it either settles and does the right thing that it's meant to do, or it will cause pain and anguish and division. Paul is saying, no, you don't need rules. We're not diluting the gospel. We're actually showing it in its true light and for what it is. So we dilute something, you remove some of its strength. You dilute the message. Don't set it forth plainly and say, look, really, this is the only way. It loses its power. And that's what Paul's saying. Not diluting anything. Actually, before God, we're doing exactly what we're meant to be doing. Actually getting rid of rules and regulations. Carrying on. Verses 3 to 6. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel, of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord. I'll just repeat that again. For we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, like, let light shine out of darkness, made this light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. Paul does admit there is a veiling in the message, but it's not being done by them. It's being done by the God of this age, God small g. God of this age, referring to Satan. And I prefer that term in the NIV, God of this age, rather than God of this world, because there's only one God of this world, and he has a big G. The God of this age has got a small g. Small g because compared to the God of the big G, the small g really has got no power at all. He has deceptive, but the overall power rests with our big God. The term veiled, we looked at that earlier on in chapter 3. If you've not seen it, you need to look at it. It's to do with comparing Moses veiling his face. But also in this veiled and this term being used here and the why that Paul is using it is because there was a particular teaching that was going around called Gnosticism, which is where we eventually get our word knowledge from in English. Now, Gnostics believed that in each and every one of you, there is a divine spark in your body that is carried around in your fleshly mortal body. And that divine spark needs releasing from your evil, sinful flesh. That's what they believed. And the best way to get this release so your divine spark can transcend this worldly place and disappear way up into the heavens and go and rest and be in basically what is paradise is to have special knowledge, special key symbols and knowledge and attain certain levels of knowledge that will release your divine spark. And to achieve these key knowledgeable places, you have to go through lots of rituals. And when you've got one bit, you're seeking out the next sort of, almost like a passcode. Do you know what I mean? It's like, right, okay, I know left to right, I've got number 24. Go back right to 23 times. And it's that sort of knowledge to release the divine spark. Paul's having a go at that and saying, no, it is not about key knowledge. It's not about knowledge at all. Jesus is the knowledge. That's all you need to know. Know Jesus and you get salvation. Know Jesus in relationship, not in rules and rituals. That's what he's talking about, the veiling. And the veiling has come, not because God has deliberately veiled somebody's face, but the God of this age has enabled and enabled somebody to be deceived and to make them believe it is knowledge that they need to be released. Certain rituals you need to go through. Funny enough, you know, today it's the same. It's knowledge that has blinded people to the truth of the gospel. It's knowledge today. Because we know so much. Well, let's rephrase that. We think we know so much about our bodies, our world. We think we are discovering new things that's going to disprove that God existed. That it's actually knowledge that is doing the veiling. We know for an absolute fact that we evolved from apes. No, we don't. It's still a theory. I just thought I'd mention that. I'm not six-day creation, but I'm just saying, you know, we know for a fact how our bodies work, so we know how to cure them when they're ill. Actually, no, we don't. Most medical experts will tell we don't know as much as people think we know. We're discovering new creatures at the bottom of the sea. That's how little we do know. We know virtually next to nothing about space because we can't reach it. But it's knowledge. We think we know something, and it's knowledge that is stopping people seeing the gospel of Christ, believe it or not. Knowledge is the veil. I'm not talking about we walk around in blind ignorance all our lives, but what I'm saying is that the last place to know Jesus is in faith. It's that leap of faith. We talk about it all the time, but it's absolutely true. It's the leap of faith that allows us to truly see the gospel of Christ. Saint Anselm says, and he was a Christian philosopher and theologian in the 11th century, and he stated this, faith seeking understanding. Not understanding seeking faith. But people are blinded today more by they think they know something, or they're looking for the next piece of information that is going to release them so they can actually know who Jesus is. There is a point that you have to take a leap of faith. Do you know Jesus is your Lord today? You took that leap of faith. And the veil was removed from your eyes. And people around the world need to see that. And sometimes I think we're in more of a battle with people than we actually recognize. They're still looking just for that key piece of knowledge. Well, you have it in the power of the undiluted gospel. And we'll sit here in church and go, yeah, we know. But when we're out there, we're like, oh, hang on a minute. Let me think. Now, I wrote that down about the undiluted gospel. No. And I sat here and with God, I went, yes, we must tell the truth plainly as it is. Not an hour later, I am talking to somebody and they're asking me a key question. And I suddenly found myself, I got a choice at this point. Either tell it like it is, the truth, John 14, I've done with it. But in my head, I started to go, oh, I just got to be a bit careful here. I don't want to upset them. Did you bear with me? No. How can I answer that in a nice way that's not going to sound too impacting, not going to sound too aggressive, but we'll give them time to think a bit more and then come back. And they'll come to the realization of John 14, 6, that Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. You know, do you know that thinking that goes through your head? Think, or leave them something to think about. And I suddenly, then literally, God went, what did you just write an hour ago? And I went, good point, Lord. So I told them flatly. I don't have any idea if they accepted it, but their face and the conversation changed very rapidly. Not by me, I hasten to add. But the questions that were being asked is because they want to know more and more and more, which is fine up to a point. And sometimes we have to say to people, do you know something? There is a point for you in your life now. There's a point in your life that you have to take the leap. You have to just accept the fact that Jesus died on that cross. He is the only way. God does exist. Make that leap today. Sometimes I think we're too scared to do that. Far too scared to do that. Why? Because we want to keep the relationship with them. Okay? But if God is saying now is the time, that's what you have to do. I don't want to upset their family. It's my mum, it's my dad, it's my sister, it's my husband, it's my wife, it's whatever. I don't want to upset the family. I never want to upset my family, but I'll upset them. No. But you know, you have to just sometimes make that leap. To use a phrase, and I'm sorry if this... Stop pussyfooting around is the... I don't know where that comes from. I think it's to do with cats, I'm hoping. But that was just in my head, and I have no idea why. But really, it means stop tiptoeing. Stop. Sometimes I think there are people now in your heads right now, you know, for years and years and years, and you have tiptoed telling them the plain truth. You're hoping they'll see it in the way that I live my life. But how many people do you come across who are not Christians, and somebody will say, do you know that person's a really nice person? They do charity stuff. They're really helpful. And they are. They absolutely are. They're people that really love other people, probably better than most Christians love other people. But they're not going to see all of that in you until you say, do you know, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, whether you like it or not. And I'm telling you this because I love you. Because it is the power unto salvation that the gospel brings. So Paul is saying, here, we will come back to Paul, but Paul is sort of saying, no, we're telling the truth plainly. It's only veiled to those by the God of this age, not by God himself. And sometimes when we tell the truth, it happens. And it's telling. Who's ever been accused of preaching? I get accused of it all the time, but that's because I do. But... who has been accused? You know when you go to tell somebody the gospel or you go to talk to them about Jesus, I don't want to preach to. Don't preach to me. Yeah? Who's out of that? Come on. Oh, man, I got it right in my early years. I lost a load of friends through it. It's brilliant. No, it wasn't. It was awful. But, hey. Yeah, you get accused of preaching. And who then suddenly goes, when you get accused of preaching, I'm not preaching to you, and you start backing down. Yeah? Yeah, there's some nods going on now. No, I'm not preaching. I'm really not. I'm trying to tell you about that Jesus loves you. And let's quickly change the subject. Yeah? The word preaching today, unfortunately, has got awful connotation to it. When Paul says that in here, that he says, we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord. That word preaching there is referring to heralding. You're a herald. Heralds would initially come in to a city that is owned by a king to come and proclaim the message of the king, whatever the king wishes to say to that city. That's what a herald does. Or a herald may also actually be somebody who's coming into the city before the king arrive to say, the king is coming. That's what Paul is talking about when he's talking about preaching. We're heralding the king's message for you. So next time you get accused of preaching, say, I know, I'm heralding in the king who's good news and you need to hear his message. And I'm doing it plainly because the herald never, ever deviated from what the king had said. The herald will be in serious trouble if he deviated from what the king had told him to herald in. So next time somebody says to you, you're preaching, go, I know. And you need to hear the message. You do it out of love, not out of cheekiness. But you say, you need to hear the message. Verse 6, for God who said, let light shine out of darkness, made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. What is this knowledge that we have? What is the power that exists that we appear to have that has impacted and removed this veil? Well, here Paul is comparing that light to the same light in Genesis 1, verse 3, the light that shined in the darkness, that brought order into what was chaos. This verse, I will tell you the truth, has not left me in the midst of all this, and until this day, I cannot tell you why. So I'll leave us all to reflect on what that means. But if that light that shone in the darkness, that brought order out of chaos, is the same power that rests within us through the power of the Holy Spirit, how much order can you bring into people's chaotic lives if you do as the king asks? Doing well, I've run completely out of time. Verses 7. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. I love verses Acts 1:8. I love the idea of the power of the Holy Spirit dwelling in me to see healing, releasing, people's minds being released from trapped in addictions. Because that's the power of the gospel. I hope everybody else does. Those that have been to Cyprus sure saw stuff going on or experienced stuff that really blew their minds. It's the power of the Holy Spirit that does all these things. It's not us. And Paul is saying that we are jars of clay. Who feels like a jar of clay today? Nice earthen jar of clay, yeah? Easily chipped, easily cracked. Nothing particularly special to look at. Sorry. But not particularly, yeah, I'm speaking for everyone. Not particularly special to look at. But this power that brought light into the darkness sits in these earthen jars. Why? Because it's to prove it all comes from God. If you was a beautifully jewel encrusted silver, platinum, gold goblet, or jar, or vase, whatever you like, if you was polished and shone in the bright sunshine, and you had that sitting in the, who would get the glory? God or you? And if you was this beautiful shiny goblet, would you not try and keep yourself shiny and polished externally at all times, rather than worrying about what's going on internally? So to be an earthen clay jar in the sight of God is the best thing to be. Because the power of the Holy Spirit rests and can be used in that rather than a jewel encrusted. So you can see I really had this imagery going on all week. Jewel encrusted goblet that looks lovely on the outside. But the glory doesn't go to God where it should go. So Paul is saying none of this, none of the power of Christ comes from within themselves. It comes from God. So he can say, when persecution comes, we are hard pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. When we go through persecution for the gospel, or what doesn't look like it's for the gospel, it looks like we're just going through grief for no reason that we can possibly understand why. Don't always try and figure it out for yourself. Remember, you are an earthen jar. Clay. The potter molded you so you could hold his power, and it's that to which you use. God looks at you, by the way, as an earthen jar and loves you as if you were a jewel encrusted goblet. But still, the power comes from him. So if today you are feeling hard pressed on every side, use the power of Christ not to be crushed. If you are perplexed, use the power of Christ not to be in despair. If you are persecuted, use the power of Christ not to feel abandoned. And if you are struck down, use the power of Christ to stand up so that you are not destroyed. This is what Paul is saying he did. This is how he knows that this ministry, this relationship he has is with the power of the risen Christ, because he uses that power to see through these troubles. That's how he knows that his relationship, his ministry is based on a relationship with Jesus, not on a set of rules and regulations. I hope that is the same for you today. Paul carries on. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may be revealed in our mortal body. So then, death is at work in us, but life is at work in you. It's about dying to ourselves so that life can exist. There's a lot more in that than just that. But I just want to say that. He's saying that they carry the death of Jesus inside. It's not about us. It's about the death of Jesus. It's his power that's done this so that life can be in others. Because it's not about us. It's about spreading the gospel, as I've said that already, to others. So sometimes we need to die in ourselves. Death needs to occur here. When you go through persecution, something else of you dies because you rely upon more upon Jesus. You come out of the other end normally with a sense, actually, some dross has been washed away from me. There's been some purification in this process. I'm going to skip to 16 to 18. You can read the in-between passage on your own. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Though outwardly we are wasting away, inwardly we are being renewed. He's saying what is going on the outside is bringing some renewal on the inside. So even though we're getting older and clearly look like maybe we've been beaten and flogged and our body does not look like it did before it was beaten and flogged, that's on the outside. What's going on the inside for Paul and Timothy is they are being renewed day by day. The Spirit of God is renewing them and refreshing them, preparing them for the day of the Lord. They are keep going. They are not crushed. So I don't know about you lot, but I personally, on the outside, I am decaying and wasting away. I have got more greys coming on day by day than I care to want to count anymore. I haven't reached 42 yet. Anyway, no, moving on. My body clearly no longer has the youthful look it ever once... No, it never had the youthful look. But anyway, but I know for a fact that the middle-aged spread is kicking in and everything else. I am decaying on the outside, and we're all decaying on the outside. Get over it. Because as you walk with Christ, you're being renewed on the inside. No cosmetic is going to get on the inside of you and renew you. So get over your looks. Joy, remind me of this message when you see me next looking in the mirror. Get over my looks. Get over what's going on the outside. Because Christ deals with what's going on in the inside and renews you, and that makes you feel 10 times better. Because you know, Christ is working in you, that spirit that's been deposited in you, that power that sits in you as a clay jar is doing much more than what aftershave, makeup, hair gel, whatever. You're decaying on the outside. It's okay. It is awful to say this, but the minute you're born, you're dying. But it is true, but you can have life in Christ. And something else I want to say, verse 17, very quickly. Paul refers to the fact that the troubles he's suffering now, if you note, are light and momentary. Yet you see in 1:8, it says, we do not want you to be deceived. We even despaired of life itself. Yet he will say here that they are light and momentary compared to the eternal glory that outweighs, is heavy, is the opposite of light, and also he says, and it's eternal. So the troubles today that we have are light and momentary, but the glory that we will inherit is eternal and so heavy, it outweighs everything else. So that's why he says when you're going through trouble, when you're going through pain, when they've gone through pain, don't look at the now because it's temporary. What you physically see with your eyes is temporary. Look at what is unseen, which is odd to say that, but look at what is unseen because that is eternal. So when you are coming to bring the power of the gospel, do not bring it diluted, bring it undiluted. Let it be known as it should be known. If you hear the king saying, I want you to herald to this person today, you herald to them. Don't sit there worrying about what people will think because your troubles today are light and momentary. Because what you will inherit, or what you have already got coming to you, should I say, far outweighs anything you will cop today. And I will say this, if you do not know Jesus and you're here today, please hear me. It's about a relationship. Stop looking for answers. Now is the time to take the leap of faith. Now is the time to make that leap and remove that veil from your eyes that has you deceived. And know that you can have life. Didn't say it's going to be easy. Never is. But it's life. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for Paul in some ways, and I thank you for his amazing mind and brain. And Lord, I thank you for the fact he was an example of a man who really just got on with it, didn't hide anything, told it like it was, told the pain that he went through, but told the great joy of knowing you. Lord, I pray for all of us that we will somehow go out this week, out today, and have that same sense, that boldness. Lord, I thank you that we are clay jars because the power comes from you. Help each and every one of us to tap into that power that you've already given us. Not for our sake, but for the sake of those who are perishing. Bless us all, praise. Bless us all. Empower us all. Bolden us all. Give us the kick, Lord, sometimes when we need it. In the name of Jesus, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.